The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to Alpari's webinar today. My name is James Hughes, Chief Market Analyst at Alpari. And this webinar is called Technical Indicators and Trading from Charts. Now, some of you might have been to this one before. It's a rescheduled one as we cut out the last time, so hopefully we won't have any technical problems with it this time. But as the title really says, there's a lot of technical indicators which people tend to use on their charts and in charting in general. And basically, what today we'll do is look at a few of my favourite ones. We'll try and put those onto some charts which are moving at the moment, and see some of the things that have been happening in the markets. And I think you can't necessarily talk about TA or trading from charts without talking about what's going on in the markets at the moment and what fundamentals are doing at the moment. So it'll be we'll touch on a few of those points. And really just go through a few examples of how we can best apply these things. Now, apologies for those of you who have been to all of the other webinars, but there's one way I start all of these, and it's by saying that there's one thing that we all have in common. All traders, all analysts, all retail traders, big banks to politicians to everyone. The one thing we all have in common is that not one of us knows where the market is going to go. Not one of us. So we can use these tools that we have in place. We can look at different charts. We can look at the fundamental news. We can look at various different indicators and oscillators and whatever it may be. But at the end of the day, we don't necessarily know where it's going to go. It's a gamble, and it's the reason why it's a little bit more of a considered gamble than all the others, because you have risk management tools in place which will save you if you get things wrong, which you inevitably will do. There is no way that you'll place 100 trades and they'll all be correct. So the whole way to make money in these sorts of trading environments is to place your trades when you're right. Don't be too greedy, and when you're wrong, make sure that your stop loss is in place and that it's not too far away. That's definitely one of those things you need to make sure happens. And people make the mistake of not placing different stops or moving their stops and moving their limits around. And it doesn't necessarily, if you do that, you will end up causing yourself more problems. And there's another old adage, which is always a good one to keep in mind. Not placing a trade is often just as profitable as placing a trade. So you don't always have to be in the market. What you can do sometimes is overcomplicate things that you look at. Overcomplicate charts, overcomplicate... It's a subject that the whole area of trading is a subject which is overcomplicated 90% of the time by people. So keeping things simple is the way I like to do things. And you can sometimes convince yourself there's a trade when there actually isn't one. So if you're not 100% sure your risk return ratio isn't where it should be, then you don't have to be in the market. You don't have to place a trade. Okay, you don't have to make sure you do. So it's definitely an idea. Keep an eye on the markets, of course, which is what we do. Use technical analysis, use these technical indicators, but make sure that that you're not placing a trade just for the sake of it. So that's the big issue. Okay, so what we've got, the way we'll start off is by looking at a slide I tend to show quite a lot now. I have to apologize because it's a little bit old, goes back to start of November. So excuse me, just bear me 1 second. Sorry about that, I thought the gremlins had come back into the system, but they haven't. Okay, right, so... this is a chart that I may have shown before last time when we first did this webinar and before everything went wrong with it, but it's the VIX chart. Now, what we always talk about in terms of technical analysis and indicators and placing trades is this is volatility. Volatility is definitely what we need for any form of trading. Every trader wants it. Every trader looks towards it, and we want to see volatility happen. Now, this is the VIX chart. Now, it's based in the US, doesn't cover all currencies and everything, but it's just a general idea of how volatility, what's going on in terms of volatility in the market. And you can see that as the market was going through the year from the end of 2010 up to the middle of the summer or so, markets weren't necessarily so volatile. They had their peaks and troughs like always, but we hadn't seen anything too drastic. Now, what has, of course, happened is the Eurozone crisis has escalated beyond belief, and we got what's happened from really the start of August, which is this area here of huge volatility within the markets. Now, you can view that as one of two things. You can say, number one, that is a bad thing, that what's going on in the Eurozone is a huge problem leading to unemployment for millions of people, poverty for a lot of people, real tough times of austerity, and that the Eurozone is the biggest issue in the world, which is undoubtedly true. But if we look at this from a trader's point of view, we want volatility. It's how we are able to make money from trading. Now, this is from a purely trader's point of view, not necessarily from a human point of view. Now, of course, people may differentiate the two between humans and traders, and I think just diverting off for a minute, there was a guy, I'm sure a few of you have seen him, but a guy that was on the BBC not long ago. He was on as an independent trader, and he came on saying, and he said something that got them all up in arms, and I did quite a few TV appearances, so I was speaking to some people there at the BBC when this guy came on the TV, and he actually said that every night he goes to bed and he prays for a market crash. He prays for something to happen, for the Eurozone to split up, or for some huge catastrophe in the markets, because he's a trader, and from a trader's point of view, all he wants is volatility, because that's how you trade. Now, of course, he was lambasted throughout the world, and in this country would never be used on TV again, became a bit of a hate figure for a little while because of, you can't go on and say that, and everyone with a company attached to them, of course, and we all know that loads and loads of people go on TV from different companies talking about the markets and where things are going, but they always have a company attached to them, very much like myself. So they have a company attached, they can't necessarily say everything that they're supposed to say. Now, a guy, an independent trader, can come out and say, I want this volatility. So bad news is good news, because it gets the markets moving. Now, of course, everyone else came on and said, well, this guy is clearly got no morals, it's a terrible thing to say, you can't say that. Well, I think secretly a lot of people were saying, well, really, he is right, because that volatility, from a trader's point of view, that is what we want to see. It's the only way we trade. If there's no volatility and the market's flatline, there's no opportunities to trade. You want big volatility. You want the market to move. Now, we don't necessarily want it when it comes hand in hand with millions of people losing their jobs and high inflation, cost of living increasing, and austerity measures throughout the world. That's not what we want. But of course, volatility is a good thing. And from a purely trader's point of view, this is what we want to see. So this sort of area on the VIX chart, that happens quite a lot. And we want to see, it doesn't happen very often. We want to see a degree of volatility, maybe not like this, but a degree of volatility to really let us trade and to really give us those opportunities. And we'll run through a few more of these points as we go through and we look at some of the charts. But one other thing that we tend to have a problem with when clients talk to me about trading and talk to me about what they're seeing in terms of their charts. Well, and sometimes we get clients send through charts to us so we can have a little look, give our opinions. Of course, we can't give trade recommendations, but we give your opinions on the charts. And by all means, if any of you want to do that after the webinar, then by all means, there is an email address which I'll give you at the end so you can do that. But what we tend to get quite a lot of times is people really overcomplicating what they do, overcomplicating trading, and really putting too many indicators on the chart. To me, the most important thing on the chart is the price action. That's what you want to see, because that's what you're trading on, of course. At the end of the day, you're trading on price action. Sometimes we see charts come in that are so overcomplicated, so jam-packed full of indicators and oscillators, you can barely even see the price action. Now, that's the most important stuff. We need to make sure that we're always looking at price action, because that's what we trade on. We don't trade on the oscillator. We don't trade on the moving average. We trade on the price action. So that would be my number one tip, is to not overcomplicate things. Now, but I do have a couple of slides here, and you will see. And I'm not going to. I don't intend to run to slides that much, but I'll just quickly show you the things that I stick to. And of course, it is the basics. So the first one, trend lines. Second one, support and resistance. And then simple moving averages. Now, probably three of the easiest technical terms to understand, the easiest technical things to keep an eye on. So I think if you need to make sure that you're looking at these basics, okay? Make sure you're keeping your eye on anything that's basic instead of overcomplicating everything. And that's the biggest problem people have. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't use various these different oscillators or different Bollinger bands or Ichimoku clouds or anything like that. All of these have their place, but of course the issue with all of them is they're not always right all of the time, and that goes for the same with any form of TA, is that you don't get an absolute science from any of them. So I tend to think that the basic ones tend to work the best. And people comment about technical analysis and technicals and say, well, there are it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, and levels are taken out and move around and they get to these levels because everyone has stops there, or everyone has limits there, or everyone's looking to trade on that level. Well, from my point of view, that doesn't necessarily matter, because if it is a self-fulfilling prophecy, then of course that's a good thing, because it means it does actually work. The big levels do work, that these various different, whether it be psychological big levels or key support and resistance levels, that they do work because other people are trading on them, and that's what you want to see. Now, I've got a prime example of that up at the moment on the MetaTrader platform here. Now, this is cable, sterling versus the US dollar, and this is over the last couple of months or so, or month and a half or so, on an hourly chart, and you can see there's been a big range trading on cable. Now, we've had a couple of breakouts of the resistance and the support levels, which I'll touch on in a minute, but this big range here is full of nothing but very simple technical terms. So support on the downside, one touch, you probably say another touch there, a slight break, but we want to look at the reactions, and that's key. Again, as I say, I mentioned that in a second. So some touches down the bottom on the support levels, some touches on the upside on the resistance levels. Now, this is a key area of trading. You've also got on here an RSI, a very basic oscillator. Now, when it comes to oscillators, people tend to get a little bit more confused about technical analysis and trading, and they shouldn't necessarily, because RSI is the most basic oscillator, or again, even one of the most basic forms of TA that you can find, is a basic overbought or oversold indicator. You have two levels. You have 70% and you have 30%, and in the middle you have the data. Okay, and what you look for is that a move above 70% indicates that the market is overbought and is looking to turn around and come lower, and vice versa on the downside. If it drops below 30%, it's oversold, is looking to bounce higher. Very simple overbought, oversold indicator. Now, when you've got a range trading anyway, then it helps you out, because when you've got this RSI trading in the middle of the area, it tells you there's no trade. It tells you it's neither overbought or oversold, so there's not a trade there. And that would coincide with what we've got here, because we are almost in the middle of this range. We know we're near the upside or the downside, so you wouldn't necessarily say there's a trade there. But definitely an idea is keep your price alerts up the top, keep your price alert down the bottom, and just keep an eye on it. Now, I said I was talking about the breakouts. Now, breakouts are key. If you are a purist technical analyst, a pure technical analyst like a lot of people are, they will say that if you follow the textbooks, that a break of a level is means the level's gone. So if you see a breakout, you completely disregard it. Now, I tend to take a different view to that, and I tend to think you need to add a bit of common sense into these things, because you get a couple of breaks, you get a couple of moves above the level, doesn't necessarily mean that level has gone. And if you look at this example, it's definitely true. You've got a couple of touches here. Probably this is your first touch that we're talking about. These lines go across the whole chart, so not much you can do about that. So you ignore anything behind here. But that's your first touch, second touch. Now you've got a break. Now, this is a break. It's a peak. Of course, it's a high. And straight away, once you get a break, you need to look at the immediate reaction. The immediate reaction by the price. So we saw the break, we saw it turn around, market comes lower, now aggressively lower. So there's still no buyers above that level. There's no buying above this sort of area that's driving the market higher. So it's not necessarily, you wouldn't say that is a key breakout. And as the rest of this shows, it clearly wasn't, because the market went lower, bounced around. Next time it came up again, came lower again. And again, you've got exactly the same sort of thing, maybe a a higher breakout, and this is the area where you're where you would worry, is because if you were trading on these highs, you'd have stop losses just above. Now, the potential of these taking you out of your stop losses is quite high, but of course, what happens when the market comes back down is you're able to get back in your trade again. So there is a break. The market does break out higher, but again, you're looking for the reaction. Straight away, the reaction is nothing. We go above and we come lower. Now, we were talking about this the other day. This is last Thursday when the ECB rate decision was. We saw a 25 basis point cut, and we were watching this live on the webinar where it was bouncing around, and we said there were trades around this level. It came up, it peaked through, but it didn't stay there. And this is the key thing. It did not stay there. The reaction was lower, and of course, all the way lower. It came all the way down. So, again, that was a key point. And we were also saying about fundamentals on Thursday, that how you trade them, whether you trade the, not necessarily fundamentals in general, but economic announcements. And we were saying, if you trade these high levels or low numbers that come out of on economic releases, you don't necessarily trade the reaction to the number, you trade the reaction to the initial price move. And that's exactly what we've got here. The initial price move was this bang up higher, straight through that level, but then this is the trade that you had. This is the reaction to the initial, to the price move. That's what you want. This is the reaction to the number. This is the reaction to the price move. So this is what we were talking about Thursday. It worked ideally well. Okay, we saw a break, and if we'd had a stop loss here, if we'd said, right, I'm going to sell when it gets up to here, and I'll put my stop loss here, yeah, we would have been stopped out initially. But when it come back lower, we'd be running on this again. So we've got the moves, we've got the indications here. So the market moves around, but this just shows that these key support and resistance levels are so easy to find. They're everywhere in charts, absolutely everywhere. Now on the downside, we've got the same thing for support. So that was our first touch. Come down there, we want to trade, stop just below the level, banging, we're going higher. Again, bouncing around, touches, couple of touches there. Now this is bit different here, different to the ones on the upside, because these were just highs that are broke. Now, we actually saw a close below this level. Now, if you're closing below the level, you may think a little bit more of it, but personally, I would still wait for the reaction. Wait for the reaction and see what this RSI is doing. Okay, that's a key point. See what the RSI is doing. And when the break did come down, this initial bar is here. The low is below that 30% level. Okay, so that's oversold. That's the market looking to go higher. So that's an indication that this reaction is going to be higher. So you look for that reaction again, and it went higher. So we're always looking for these. It's a good idea to keep your eye out and just give these any breakouts a little bit of leeway. Okay, let's get back to this. Now we look at that was support and resistance. We jumped across trend lines a little bit, but I've got a key example of a trend line now. Hopefully everyone knows what a trend line is. If you don't, it's there on the screen. I'll just read it through. Three types of basic trends: uptrend, downtrend, and a trading range. Okay, so very simple. Uptrend's going up, downtrend going down, trading range going sideways. Okay, so this is the key chart. Now this is just a one minute chart that we're looking at here. This was Dollar Swiss, which of course was one of those charts which was all over the place, absolutely everywhere, all the time. So market was going higher. Now, with a trend, the textbooks say you need three touches of a trend line to say that that's a trend, and then you can trade. Now, again, this is all about keeping it simple, and giving it a little bit of leeway. So one touch there, never obviously trade on one touch, never know what the market's doing. Second touch there, market is definitely going up. Now, the third touch doesn't come to all the way up here. Now, you'd miss out on all this if you were looking for those three trends. Now, this is the key thing, that trends can happen anywhere, any time frame. This is only 1 minute, and we're talking a couple of hours here, but that's still a trend. You can still have that as a trend. Now, when this comes down here, market moves higher, you've missed out on all this. This is where you would trade. You'd only get that, and then you'd get burnt if you were looking to the textbooks. Now, I would say personally, around here is where you start thinking, well, this is trended, especially when it bounces there. So you can almost take that as your third one, because the market comes down and it bounces off higher. So around here, you'd be looking to trade, get into that. Okay, you lose out here, but then when it comes down, you trade again to get a small high, get a small upside there. But a break, of course, would lead us to going the other way, and you would have our stop just below this trend line as well, which is always the case. So would be protected. But the market came lower, and the game went higher again. And we had one, two, three touches. Again, you'd be looking probably around here when the market came down and then shot higher. So that's where how you're looking. That's how you look at trend lines. They're very basic, very, very basic indeed. Looking at the support and resistance, sorry, they're very basic indeed, but they work, and they work all the time. And when we don't have that volatility that we're talking about, that we so long for, then, of course, we have these bouncing around. Support and resistance we covered. We covered those a second ago. We know support and resistance, how it works. Moving averages are another key one. Now, I tend to have, especially on a daily chart, and let's flip back to MT4. Right, I do have an example of a daily chart somewhere around here. Maybe it is towards the end. Maybe I don't. Okay, anyway, I tend to have a 50, 100, and 200-day moving average attached to my charts. Now, it doesn't matter if they're daily or hourly or whatever. Sometimes instead of 50, some people like to use 55 because of the Fibonacci connections to that. But I tend to think they work pretty well. Now, this is just a 100 and 200 on here, this one. But let's go to something. This just makes something and just go daily and have a look what they're doing. There we go. And so the way we put our moving averages on, indicators, they're trend indicators, and the moving averages. So we go 50. Okay, now it's a bit long-winded to do it like this on the MT4 platform, so I do apologize. 100. Okay, and then let's add one more. And 200. Now, they're all the same color, which is a bit of a pain, but they act as a form of floating support and resistance. Now, you can look two ways. You can either look for crosses in them, or you can look for forms of floating support and resistance. And if you look at that, what would that be? That's probably the 100-day moving average, and it's this one here running down. You've got that form of floating support and resistance. Now, from this point of view, and remember this is daily, so this is a little bit more long-term. We're going back to October here. The market's come down, gone higher. Now, that is an ideal touch. The purists would like that one as well. Market down. So you would definitely look towards moving averages as a form of floating support and resistance. And even on that cable chart where we had the short-term stuff, okay, a break there. This is more short-term, but this is only a couple of days, but there's definitely a form of resistance on the upside there as well when the market comes along to that 200-day again. So, again, you're looking towards those sort of levels as a floating form of support and resistance. When the markets are very choppy, it's hard to look for the crosses because crosses can be false breakouts, and you don't necessarily want those. They're always very difficult to gauge on. Now, the last thing I like to use, and it's a little bit more complicated than the other things, is Fibonacci numbers. Now, I won't go through necessarily the mathematics. I'll show you some of the examples, but basically, the Fibonacci numbers are a form of support and resistance, and they were generated by this 18th century mathematician, Leonardo Fibonacci. I think he's a lot older than that, to be perfectly honest. But the way you look for them is by adding these Fib numbers and you're looking for a retracement. This is the way I use them. This is a Fibonacci retracement line. This is third quarter 2011 euro dollar. Now you've got a high. This is a daily chart. So you've got the move there. That's the initial move that we saw. And what we're looking for is a retracement of that move, where the markets are going to come to. So this was the initial move, and this is the start of the retracement. Now we've got the retracement lines on. Now with Fibonacci, you look for there's a few numbers that you look for. Now, 61.8 is the key number on Fibonacci. Okay, that's the key one we look for. And like we were saying before about support and resistance, you have to give it a little bit of leeway, a little bit of time either way. This is in the textbooks about Fibonacci, is that you give it leeway. If there is a break, you look for the reaction. And that's a key thing. So you've got two ideas here. Okay, on the upside, you've got 38.2. The market's broken all the way down. Initially, it broke this 50% level. Now break, and again, as we say, we look for the reaction. Next candle higher. So, but we've got the upside acting as the resistance level here. But the key one on this chart is the 61.8% retracement. Now, big downward candle came to there, changed, turned around, went higher. The reaction the next day, that's what we got. So you're always looking for that reaction on Fibonacci retracement charts, that's there on retracement lines. And it's always, the key ones are 38.2, 50% and 61.8. Those ones are always the ones that people look at the most. And really, from a Fibonacci point of view, you don't really use 50, because 50 is just half of the retracement, of course, that's why it's in there. But it tends to work. But the ones that work the most are 38.2 and 61.8. So let's move across here. Now, this is a 50% one that we're looking at here. Now, big move. This is the move we're looking at on dollar Swiss. This is a daily chart, and this was the big move, dollar Swiss, where everyone was talking about the market. So the move higher came, break through 38.2, but 50% held up. Market came down, market went higher. Okay, so this 50% level is again where we're looking for. That's where we want to keep an eye on it. That's where we'd be looking to trade next. Now, I apologize, these are slightly older examples. This is from October 2011. So the moves are there. So the 50% level on the upside is also coupled with a few touches of a resistance level on the top there. So you can keep an eye on those. But I tend to like Fibonacci's. They're a good form of trading. So now we've got cable. So early November this is. So this is the move we're looking for, this move. And then what we've got here is 38.2 acting as the level. Now this is afterwards. Now what we'd probably do here, this is slightly before the move, so we could have maybe come out a little bit further on this one, but 38.2 acting as that support in resistance. In fact, we've got resistance to this sort of level. Now this really put this onto, oh sorry, there's one more here. This is dollar Noki again. So this is the initial move, then you've got the move down, 38.2 acting as real support level underneath that. So one break lower, reaction higher, one break lower, reaction higher. Again, looking for those reactions. And then straight touches. That's exactly what we want. And then the market went higher. So that dollar Noki one is an ideal one. October, November 2011. Okay, now let's have just a brief look. We're running out of time. Let's have a brief look at an example of these on the recent chart. Now, this is a five-minute chart. This is happening at the moment. This is the move euro-dollar. Okay, so this is the move from earlier this morning. So the move higher, that's what we're looking at, 61.8. Again, looking for reaction. So a break, reaction higher. A break, reaction higher initially, but led to another break, but then reaction higher again. So Fibonacci, and what number is it on? It's on 61.8% retracement. And that is the key. That is the key one. So, I mean, they are all real basic forms of TA. Real, real basic forms. There's nothing too strenuous within there. There's nothing that takes too much working out. And people always talk about the mathematics behind everything and how it tends to work. Now, I tend to not necessarily care too much about the mathematics or how they work. I tend to think, just give me an idea on what I'm supposed to look for. How do I spot buying and selling signals? That's how I want to look at it. I don't necessarily care how it's calculated and where it works and what are the mathematics behind how it works. Just tell me where my buying and selling signals are, and I'm happy with that. So that's the way I tend to look towards these things. But they are really full basic forms of TA. Keeping an eye on these sort of levels will give you countless opportunities. But there's always, of course, there's a couple of things to remember. You don't always have to place a trade. And the more bits you put on your charts, the more indicators you put on your charts, the more likely you are to force yourself to trade. Because, of course, they're all telling you different things. So there will always be, if you put enough indicators on your chart, you'll always find a trade. There will always be one indicator which is telling you you can do something. But it won't necessarily be the best one. It won't necessarily be a great trade. So you just have to, I tend to look for those basic forms because they're the ones that tend to work the more often. They give you less false signals. Okay, so always a way to look at those. And of course, the other side is make sure you've got your stops and limits in place, because none of these things are an exact science. They will either work or they won't work, and there's nothing you can do about it, unfortunately. And the only thing you can do is have a stop loss underneath it, so that if it does go wrong, you're protected. If it goes higher and it breaks out, then make sure your limit's in place and it'll take your profit for you. Don't get greedy on those winning trades. Apart from that, thank you very much for listening. Now, if you do have any questions at all, please feel free to email webinars@alpari.co.uk. Okay, webinars@alpari.co.uk. I'll pick up any of those emails, and I'm always willing to answer any questions you do have, any charts you want to look at. I can't give a trading advice. I can't tell you to buy here or sell there or put your stop there, but I'm more than happy to look at them and discuss various different opportunities on them for you. So by all means, drop me an email and I will answer. Apart from that, this is the last webinar before Christmas, so everyone have a very nice Christmas and a great new year, and we'll see you in the new year. Thank you very much.